How was lunch? Ah, that energy is not enough. How was lunch? Come on, guys. It's not going to be a serious talk. Don't worry. Just don't be like, oh my God. I saw that video. I saw that video and it reminded me of something. While I was preparing for my talk, the only difference was I ate donne biryani and slept. Like, I thought I will start preparing after I eat the donne biryani, but it didn't happen. But yeah, thank you so much to the organizers for having me here. My name is Satish Perumal. I've been doing comedy for 4.5 years in the city. 1 year, 3 months, I've taken it full time. I quit my advertising job to do it. I don't know why, but... But yeah, so what I'm going to talk about today, it's a bit different. It's a bit different. I'm going to talk about, you guys have seen a lot of comics, I'm sure. Like, I'm sure all of you have seen some or the other part of stand-up comedy in the country. I'm going to talk about something which is, you guys might not know. You guys, it's not going to be a lecture. You guys might not know about this. It's what happens off stage. So what actually a comic goes through off stage is what I'm going to talk about. So basically, I'm going to talk about beyond the laughter. Okay? So you guys, how many of you have seen live stand-up comedy here? How many of you have seen? Okay, YouTube, on YouTube? Okay, a lot of you. Okay, cool. So usually what happens is, you guys might see that videos are there on YouTube. You guys might love the videos, you guys might laugh, you guys might share it. I'm sure all of you have done that. But there is an aspect of it which goes behind. Like, easily, I would say, if a comic has to write a piece of 3 minutes of material, it takes a comic close to 6 to 8 months. It takes 6 to 8 months to write a 3 minutes piece of material. Jerry Seinfeld takes 8 years to write 1 hour. So when next time someone asks you, tell me a joke, tell them, dude, wait for like 4 months, please. I will get back to you after 4 months. But yeah, it happens. It's very difficult because there is a science. Comedy is both a science and an art. Like, I don't know, like, how many of you know about it? It's both like science and an art. Because what happens in comedy is it's just not knock-knock jokes. It is not knock-knock jokes. It is observation. It is things that have happened in your life. If you take like people, like a lot of people who talk about political things, they talk about a little bit things that are a bit edgy. I usually stick to topics about which are close to my heart, which I have been born and raised with, because I don't want to get shot. So I love my life. It's nice. But I talk about these things because it is very personal to me. I feel nice about it. It's very easy for me to talk about them as well. But there are a lot of comics out in the country who talk about a lot of different stuff. They try to enable people's mindsets and try to change their mindsets. So I usually don't get into that because I'm comfortable with what I speak in. So usually what we go through off stage after we finish a show is that when we take a topic, for example, like if you take a topic, like I come from a defense family. So if I take a defense thing, so I come, both my parents are from the defense. So I take the defense angle and I'll be like, what are the different things that I can talk about defense? So there's something called as a bubble that you put like defense as a word, and then we talk about all the other 10, 20 things that are there around defense. For me to write that entire bit, it took me around 8 months. And it's a 4 minute joke. And we do something called as open mics in the city. There's something called open mics, wherein we go try all our new material on and on and on. Like, after I write a defense joke, I'll have to go to at least 300 to 250 open mics to get that joke crafted. So there's a lot of work that goes behind it. That's why we keep hitting every single open mic to check the array of the joke. Like, will it work across different audiences? If it doesn't, then we can it. Usually every show that we do as an open mic, we record this, we record the sound of the show. Every show is recorded. So we go back home, we listen to it, we'll be like, okay, this word is not right. We'll have to change this word in the next show. This structuring is not right. We'll have to change the structure in the next show. So we go through a lot of work to churn out one piece of joke. So I'll give you an example of how the joke transformed. So I say I come from a defense family. Usually I start off by saying that, hey, I'm from Bangalore. I've been born and raised in Bangalore. It's my second favorite city in the world. First is, of course, New York. I've never been to New York. I just have it on my phone as Google app. It's great. When I get bored, I just check it. So I start off by saying that. So I build it up by saying that. And then I get into that. Like, I ask how many people are from Bangalore. Like, people are like, hey, 2, 3, 4. Because usually we don't find that many Bangaloreans in the city. Then I ask, like, how many defense kids do we have? Then people are like, how many defense kids do we have here? 3. At the back, always. So yeah, so I ask that question, and then I get into, because I build a base saying that I'm from Bangalore, I'm a defense kid, get a sort of relatability with the audience, and then I get into the joke. So I start off by saying that I'm a defense kid. It's great to be from the defense. It's absolutely great for my parents. because the stars and stripes on their shoulders and all the accolades that they get is good for them. It is very difficult for us because our life is always put under a microscope while growing up as a kid. Our life is like a Bonneville chocolate when we grow up. Our parents will always come up to us and ask us, have you earned it? So I've built that base there, saying that, okay, parents are there, it is good for them, it's great for them. For me, it is difficult to grow up. Then I get into a bit more detailing of it. I get into detailing of it and I say that, how many of you know that in defense we have something called as a CSD canteen? Yeah, all of you know it. We have a CSD canteen in defense. CSD canteen is a very, very cheap place. You guys know it? Yeah? Aaron, we are the only official sponsors of alcohol for all our friends. That is the only reason that canteen is used for. That is the only reason I know it's used for. And it's a very cheap place, right? It's a very cheap place. You get, oh, it's like a very cheap place. And I'm pretty sure I was conceived there. Because my parents walked into the canteen, they said, cheap reduce, let's make some cheap reduce. So that's how you build the joke, you build the joke, you build the joke, you build the joke. And then I ended by saying that I'm different to such an extent that I'm born on August 15th. I am born on August 15th. My dad genuinely believed in the concept of Janda Uncha Rahe Hamara. So that joke was one of the first jokes that I wrote 4.5 years back. So for me to get to that point of like, how do I end this joke? Was extremely difficult because you need to keep trying it, keep trying it, keep trying it. Then you'll be like, okay, fine. There is an end to this. I can do it this way. It takes a lot of hard work, but it pays off. It pays off. And what happens is usually when you're doing comedy, because comedy is very subjective. Like, for example, the person on your right might like it. The person on your left will be like, meh. It happens all the time. It happens all the time. So to cater to all the audiences, we see that if we can get jokes on different topics. We try to do that, but it's extremely impossible. Like, we can't talk about everything under the sun, right? So I start up, I say this, I finish that. And then because I say that, I'm just telling you how structuring functions. I'm just telling you how structuring functions. So I finish off that because then I say that I love traveling. Like, how many fans of traveling do we have here? Got a few, okay. I love traveling not because I am an avid traveler. It's because I come from a defense family. We were forced to travel. So I finish the first joke and I get into the second joke. And then I say that because of traveling so much, I got to see a lot of aspects about India. I got to see that Indians are, we typecast people all the time. We always put people into different baskets. We always say South Indians can't develop dark circles. We always say people in the North have a fixation with their mothers and sisters or someone else's mothers and sisters. And say people in the West believe in the concept of progress. That's a good thing. It's a good thing. But we, as humans, tend to do these things. Because of traveling, I got to see all of this. We tend to do it. But recently, I came across a device called as a DSLR. How many of you know this device? All of you know it? All of you know it? We as humans are a bit racist, yes, I agree. But we go one step ahead, and we created a machine which is racist in nature. I'll tell you why. Because every single time when I used to pose in front of this DSLR, it only had one thing to tell me every single time. It always used to say, the subject is too dark. See, I have no issues in people calling me dark, absolutely none. But let's get our facts straight. That thing is charcoal black. I am chocolate brown. At least I think I am. So I finished that bit, and then I spoke about progress, right? I spoke about progress. So I get into the next bit. Like, I was dating a girl 3.5 years back. She was from Gujarat. She also believed in the concept of progress, hence moved on. So you break it down that way. You keep breaking it down that way. And then I say, when we were dating, she came, she told me, let's go meet my parents. Let's go meet my parents. Let's take this step to another world. I was like, wow, great. Come, let's go meet my parents. So I'm sitting here. I go meet her dad. I'm sitting here. Her dad is sitting there. She's sitting here. First question, her dad looks at me. Strict man, very, very strict man. First question, he looks at me and he's like, Beta, what car do you drive? I look at him and say, Uncle, this is a helmet. And then because I baffled him, like he doesn't know what to say next. And he's like, okay, tell me, beta, how many bedrooms you have in your house? It's like, your daughter should know. I didn't say that. But see, I started off by talking about coming from a different family. Then I talk about traveling. Then I talk about how we are like racist in nature. Then I talk about how I had a girlfriend who was like believed in progress left. And then how I finished it off by going and meeting her parents. So there's a structuring that happens. So when we do comedy, we always think of how one joke flows to the next joke. It's called a segue. So how will it flow into the next joke? So basic, there are three basic rules of comedy. Okay, there's something called as a setup. Okay, this first thing is a premise. First thing is your premise. Like, what do you want to talk about? What do you want to talk about? You, for example, you want to talk about engineering. There it's a chuckle. If you want to talk about engineering, engineering is your premise. Like, okay, what about engineering? You break it down. What about engineering? Is it the professors? Is it the course? Is it the college? Is it the canteen? Is it the traffic? Like, you can break it down to so many different levels. That will be your setup. So that'll be your premise, Setup will be what you want to talk about engineering. What is that one aspect that you want to talk about engineering? Like three, four different aspects that you want to talk about. Then you start writing on those aspects. And then you come finally to the punchline. Punchline is where you build it up completely and then you finish it off with a great punchline when people are like, haha, hey, nice. He's done his research. So I speak about all of this. Then I get into another aspect of my life. So I've spoken about how I was born, I traveled, and this happened in my life. And then I get into the next level when I started working. So once I started working, I always wanted to be an advertising professional. So I was working as an advertising professional in the city. And I 6 years, 6.5 years, I was working as an advertising professional. It was great to be in advertising because advertising had only three simple rules. No hierarchy, no restrictions, no salary. Because when they gave you your basic salary slip, they weren't joking. It is the actual basic that you can get in life. So you finish that, I talk about, like, I just give a basic heads up of where I come from, what I've done. And then I get into the aspect of what I was doing in advertising. So I say, I was doing this, I was working in advertising, but in Bangalore, I used to work in the sector of advertising called real estate advertising. Because it's very weird to work in real estate advertising. Because the way we market every single project of ours, like every project has to be 10 minutes from MG Road. No matter where this goddamn project is located, it has to be 10 minutes from MG Road. Like we use MG Road in every single piece of communication. Fine, that's absolutely cool. But as marketeers, we go one step ahead and we say that we have a fully functioning helipad, please buy our apartment. My only question is, who uses a helipad in the city? The only guy who could use it is absconding. So I don't know how many of you noticed that. So I built it up, spoke about advertising, spoke about what I did in advertising. Then the last thing is the punch. So that is where you build up and then you lead to the punchline where people are like, ha, okay, he's done his research. So comedy is, like they say, comedy is a serious business. It's actually a serious business now. And it's picking up really well in the country. We have like great comics in the country at the moment. People are doing their specials and stuff like that. And it's going to grow really, really well. I think in the next 5-6 years, we would be probably competing with the Westerners with respect to the amount of content that's coming out in comedy in this country. But what goes behind, it's actually a job. It is a corporate job. It is a corporate job wherein you wake up at 12:30. That's the only thing. Like wake up at 12:30, then start writing for another 5 hours. Finish in 5 hours, you're done. But for us to get to that point of wherein I need to talk about something, is a lot of hard work. It's a lot of hard work because we write, we think it's funny, and never, if you guys ever want to do comedy, any of your aspiring comics here, do not try your jokes on friends. Never do it. My best friend is sitting right in front right now. First open mic, which I did 4.5 years back in Urban Solace, we had three people, two of them were my friends. And I don't even want to say what those jokes were because I have the recording, and if I see it today, you guys be like, who invited this guy on this stage? It is that bad. But that's why friends will always laugh at everything. Friends will always laugh. They will support you. That is why if you guys want to do comedy, do not call friends for any of your shows. Just don't try it in front of them. Don't call them. Use it. Use your jokes. Use your time in front of random strangers. Only then, because getting on stage and doing this day in and day out takes a toll on your body as well. Because mentally, physically, because we've had shows wherein we've had 1,500 people rapturous applause, standing ovation. I've done a show wherein I'm speaking midway. There is this elderly ma'am who was sitting in front, hoity-toity lady, very, very hoity-toity. I was just doing a joke, and she stops me in between, and she starts taunting me. She's like, you think we're not intelligent people? I can throw money on your face right now, blah, 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 X, Y, Z. So, and this was the first show that I did after I quit my job. The first show. Like a bunch of 70, 80 people who are 50 plus, they were having a high tea and cocktail, whatever they were having. So I never cried that much in my life. I've never cried that much. And this is at a public event when I'm on stage and I'm bawling. I'm crying on stage in front of 80 people. Because they didn't let me complete even a single joke. They were completing everything for me. They were like, I was just talking about something, they will interrupt me. They're talking. So after a point, I just couldn't take it anymore. But that is the best part about this profession. You have your highs and you have your extreme lows. But you need to stick to it. You need to keep doing it. While I was working as well, because advertising was quite strenuous, we didn't have timings as such. We didn't have timings. So I used to finish work, go hit open mics, test my jokes, come back to work, stay the entire night, come back to office in the morning, stay in office, go back to open mic, come back to office. That was my routine for 3.5 years till I quit my job. It is extremely strenuous, but at the end of the day, if you can crack it, there's nothing like it. It's a great profession to be in. And probably my parting advice to you guys is never give up. Never, ever give up. I never knew that I will be here on this stage at one point in time in my life. I never knew that. I never knew. Like 2 years back, if you told me, I'd be like, no chance. I'd be doing open mics all my life. But the only advice I can give you all is never give up. If you guys believe in something, keep doing it. Engineering, I don't know, but still. But yeah, never, if you believe in something, just do it. If you have a passion that you want to follow, please do it. Like, you never know where it's going to lead you. And you need to have support from your friends and your family, which of course will happen eventually. Like, it'll definitely happen. So never give up, keep doing what you guys are doing. And I'm sure, like, from here, at least I would have inspired one person to become a stand-up comic. Great response, no? Not even one person's like, it's not even one like, hey, me. But yeah, my only parting advice is please never give up in life. And never doubt yourself. Never ever doubt yourself. If you start questioning yourself, there is no one who can support you then. Do not put that seed of thought in your head saying that you can't do it. If you put that seed of thought in your head saying that you can't do it, then you will never be able to do it. Like, please always say you can do it and you will do it. And I'm sure all of you all will do something great in your life. That's been my time. I've been Satish Perumal. Thank you so much for being such a patient audience.